Baby, it's hot outside.
Oh, don't you dare look back. Just keep your eyes on me. I said you're holding back. She said, shut up and dance with me. This woman is my destiny. She said, ooh, shut up and dance with me. We were victims of the night.
Hello. And welcome to what I think is episode 53 of Knit Sense. I wasn't prepared to record today, but I decided I'm going to keep this going. I'm going to keep it moving, and it's Saturday. I recorded last Saturday, so I decided I'm jumping in. If I stop too long to think about it, I'm going to find a reason not to do it. So I think it's episode 53. My name is Jan. You can find me as Jan Ellen RN on Ravelry, on Instagram, and on Fragrantica. And I'll talk a little bit more about that website later on in our new fragrance section. I hope everybody is doing well. I know it was hard for me to break away from the Yankee game that is currently going on right now. The Yankees are playing the Boston Red Sox in London today. But I did go out to the yarn store, which is part of the reason why I said, you know, I got to record. I went to the yarn store. I got to record and show you all what I hauled home, which isn't much. I was good. But when I came home, I watched, was it three runs score on a double or triple, and then Judge finished it off with a two-run homer. So I think it's now 11-6 or something like that. But I don't want to offend my Boston friends. I don't shoot the messenger. I'm just reporting the score. That's all. Anyway, I'll watch it later on the replay. This is much more important. We have to get our priorities straight. So let's see, today is Saturday. I don't know what day it is. It's the 29th, June 29th. And I just realized that my computer is plugged into the wall, but not plugged in. Hold on. I don't want to edit this out. That's too much work. Hold on. Okay. If I don't have it plugged in, it dims. So let's, okay, there we go. Ooh. All right, we're off and running, typical form. Okay, it is Saturday, June 29th. I am very glad that I was able to renew my car registration that I completely forgot about online and that you can print out, because the last time my license expired, I did not realize it expired until the day it expired, which just so happens to be on your birthday. So I spent 2 hours on my birthday in the DMV in the most brutal heat. I think it was over 100 degrees that day. I wasn't happy. So I never let that happen again. But anyway, I didn't realize that my car registration was about to expire, even though they sent me 3 emails. How they got my email address? I don't know. How did they get your email address? Anyway, they did, and they did notify me, and I just ignored it and ignored it and ignored it until I was like, ooh, that's punched out June. That's a 6. I think I'm in trouble here. I don't want to stand online. So anyway, that's all taken care of. So I know it's the end of the month. It's June 28th. And it's been hot here. Somebody turned up the heat. It is hot. The rain, which we'd been living with, this humid, miserable rain, has given way to brutal heat. I don't know which one I'd rather have. To me, I would rather have snow. So either way, I hope it is nice where you are, and you are enjoying a good weekend. This week, let's see. I think I can actually honestly put this into a reasonable length episode, because it's only been a week. I can only do just so much in a week. So I do have some knitting progress. I do have a finished object. Not blocked, ends not woven in, But so, you know, it's still typical me, but I do have a finished object. I have a little stash enhancement, and obviously one cup of this was not enough. Mm-mm. I need more caffeine. And I do have a fragrance to talk about at the end. So as I said in my last podcast, I wanted to put the scents back into Knit Scents because I have found myself this spring and summer, did start before I started recording, on a fragrance journey, really to find out what kinds of notes I like, why do I like something, why don't I like something, and I'll go more into it in the end, and really to make smart fragrance decisions. So I did discover some websites, and I've been trying new fragrances and this and that, so we'll talk about that at the end if you are interested. If you are not, I totally get it. Not only am I not offended if you tune out before that part, I just have to say that I am just so beyond honored and humbled that anybody, be it one person, 10 people, 20 people, would want to just sit and listen to something that I have to say. I'm such a little podcaster. I don't even come up as a blip on the radar. You kind of almost have to really look for me. And I'm fine with that. I really, really am, because I am just so grateful to anyone that tunes in and just enjoys or even just is willing to give me a chance to listen to what I have to say. And one thing I do want to say, and I know that there's been a lot of turmoil and upheaval going on in the community, and I try very hard in my own life, certainly online, to stay out of drama and to stay in my own lane and just not get involved, because it's, to me, I always say it's very hard. You can say that you see the other guy's side or this or that or whatever, but until you've walked in someone else's shoes, until you have walked a mile in somebody else's shoes, you can't really know how they feel. And to that end, I want to just say that, and I know I'm small potatoes. I know that I fly under the radar. 99% of people don't even know I'm out here podcasting. I am totally fine with that. But I do want anyone who does watch and anyone who does happen by here to know that everyone is welcome here. And I try to support as many designers, as many dyers, and feature as many dyers and designers and creators as I possibly can. I don't look at labels or anything along those lines. And I don't want anyone to feel that they are not welcome here, that they are being slighted here or marginalized here. I'm not about that. I have experienced that myself in many ways, and I would never want to ever, it would kill me to think anybody felt that way from anything I said or I did. As far as Ravelry goes, and I know it's a sticky wicket and it's a sticky situation right now, and I do, you know, I have to be honest. That's me. I have to speak out and I have to be honest. I wish, in my mind, and I guess you kind of have to say what you have to say sometimes. You really, you know, as much as you try to stay out of things and try to stay out of drama, sometimes when something, you have to speak out for something. And I think this is one of those times. As far as I'm concerned, I wish, if it were me, I wish that Casey at this particular point in time just banned all talk of politics on Ravelry. Personally, I don't go there for politics. If I want a dose of politics, there's plenty of channels I could put on and get a dose of it. I try to avoid it, to be honest, at all costs. But I will say that I support Ravelry in their decision. I understand why they made that decision, and I do support them. I had to take a step back because I was getting very bothered and a little too emotional. So as I said, I do support Ravelry. I think their hearts are in the right place. And I think it's the promotion of the hatred and the homophobia, the racism, the anti-Semitism, the anti-immigration, anti-everybody that doesn't look like what you think they should look like, that drew the line in the sand. So I know this went way over what I wanted to get into about it. And normally, like I said, I don't take a stand on these things. I kind of just don't even feel like I'm big enough or watched enough or viewed enough or anybody cares enough to hear what I have to say. But Ravelry is such an integral part of our knitting community. And I spent a lot of time there. I don't know about anybody else. I don't get involved, so I didn't see any of this kind of support or whatever, because I don't go in those forums. I'm on spinning forums. I'm on designer forums. And almost every forum I've been on has been very welcoming and whatnot. And can we do better? Yes, I'm sure we can. And I'm grateful for people that feel marginalized who speak out and say, you know, you need to do more here and you need to do more there. And please feel free to post in the comment section below. I read a lot of those articles and everyone can do better. But it's very hard to do better when you see good in people that are doing bad. That's a tough place to come back from. I'm done. I'm off my soapbox. I'm done. Let's move on to the knitting. Okay. What do we have on the needles? Boy, I hope I can edit some of this because boy, oh boy, did I go over. Okay, let's see. I pulled out and I'm getting old. Okay, I'm getting old. I know I'm going off again on a tangent. This is really ridiculous. I don't know, maybe it's a symptom of getting old. But I didn't get a chance to see Old Timers Day. What the hell is my party pony doing? Do you believe this? I'm back in a party pony. It's 500 degrees outside. I watched the reruns of Old Timers Day from the Yankees the other night. And if I didn't feel old enough already from my stiff joints and all this other crap going on, these were players that I watched in their prime, you know, playing ball. Bunch of old men. Oh, my God. They were all a bunch of old men. And I'm sitting there going, was that like me? Like, oh, great. Great. Now I'm really feeling good. My point being that I think my memory is shot because I can't remember if I showed this last week or not. So we're just going to move on. I think I did. So I did make some progress on this. And I have to thank, I think her, I had asked for people to put in the comment section below if they could think of anything, any kind of terminology or disorder for fear of finishing objects. And I think her name on here is Eli of Florida or Eli of Florida Coast or something. I think your name is Elise, if I'm not mistaken. And I have to thank you because you actually cracked me up. I love what you came up with. And that is what we are calling it from now on. It is called a FOFO, a fear of finished objects. And it is a FOFO. So for our podcast, when you are afraid or have fear or picking up a FOFO, that's what we're going to call it. So y'all know a FOFO is fear of finished objects. So here's FOFO number one that we are actually pushing ahead and getting finished. And it is called Mirage. I believe it is a pattern by Shelly Anderson. It was put out by Shibui Nets. And I know there's some issue going on right now with Shibui, but I started this a year ago. That's the finished object. I am doing the tank, although this pattern also comes with an option to put sleeves on it and make it a, they call this the shell and one is the T. I don't know. Whatever. You can make it this or with sleeves. Okay, I'm making the tank top in the white. Sheer panel shot, Shelly Anderson. Okay, so this has been laying around in my bag from last year. How difficult is it to make a stockinette tank top? Come on, why is it sitting here? Because it's a OFO, that's why. So here we go. This is the back. It is all finished. Okay, you have the sheer panel on the back. I know I showed this last week. And the armholes, she did a little bit of short row shaping. Now, I think I made a mistake because I have been doing German short rows lately and really loving them. I really like the way they look. And German short rows, you have to go, like if it says knit to three from the end, you have to knit to four, to two from the end because you're wrapping that third stitch, if I made sense. Well, this pattern actually assumed you were doing German short rows. So I think on the back, I might have gotten off. I ended up with the right number of stitches, but I think my short row shaping may be off. I don't care. Whatever it is, it is. Here's the back, all nice and done. And I did cast on the front, and it's sat, and it's sat, and it's sat, and it's sat. But it's not sat anymore. I finished the right front shoulder right there, and I'm almost finished with the left front shoulder, and then the upshot is I just actually I think it's the pattern says to block it first. I don't know what hit that door. That must have been one huge bug. All right, it's a bug. 45 minutes of barking that's going to take me who knows how long, if I can even. I'm going to try to show. Hey, guys, come here. Come here. Didn't work. Looking for animals? No animals. Emma. Emmy, you want to say hi? Come here. Scoot over here. Oh, you cutie. Oh, you want to say hello? Okay. All right. Come here.
You have to be careful with Emmy.
Because,
oh, my little
ducksy. Okay. Mommy gotcha. Emmy is paralyzed. Yeah. But she does move her back. She has made some progress.
Oh, sweetie. Yeah, you're my good girl.
You're such my good girl, but you're looking the wrong way, you superstar.
There you go. It's my little princess.
My little princess, Emmy. Yeah. So,
yeah, she scoots around. She doesn't really walk
on her legs, but she barks a lot. Anyway, so yes. So I think I have to block both pieces. And then, actually, I don't know if you block both pieces. Whatever. You block them and either do the three-needle bind-off or do the three-needle bind-off and then block them and seam them. And I'm kind of a little nervous about the seaming part because it's not my thing. So it's funny, when I was in the yarn store today, I asked them about, do they offer classes on seaming? And she said, you can do like a one-on-one on it. And I'm like, that's not a bad idea. I think I actually just might do that. But when I looked at the one that she knit in the store in the sample, and I'm looking at mine, now ask me, did I do a gauge swatch? No. Will this fit me? I think so. I made the armholes a little smaller as per a lot of people's advice, but her stitches are a lot tighter than mine. So yeah, I think from now on, I kind of need to do some gauge swatching because I don't know. Everything seems to fit, but I'm not so sure I'm crazy about the fabric. So this, I am hoping, will be a FO, not a FOFO, an FO for next week. All right, that goes down. I did pick up, and I don't think I went into this, I showed this last week. If I did, well, then I did. This is my Deschene. And those of you who have been watching for a while, you've seen this before. I knit this, or was working on it, last summer. In fact, I think I've been working on it for 2 summers. Yeah, this is another one of those. If you remember my Weekender sweater, where I took a trip down the Nile, the River Nile, knit the whole thing up, realized it was 7 sizes too big and had to rip it back. Yeah, I had to rip this back. Like I said, I'm starting to gather that I am more of a loose knitter than I ever thought I was. So I knit this in a larger size and just realized, even with all of that ease, 2 of me was going to fit in it. So I ripped out the entire sweater. I re-knit the front. I'm going to stand up here. Squeaky chair noise. Wouldn't be a podcast without it. Okay. So here's the front. And it is, again, supposed to have a lot of positive ease. I'm fine with that. My intention for this, I want to wear this over sundresses. Okay. Now, I have been on a quest to find a long... I don't know about you, but that was giving me a headache. Okay. This is linen. I lost the tags and I did not put this project on Ravelry. But I do know that what I'm knitting this out of is linen. I believe I got this yarn 2 years ago at the House of Yarn when I was down in Nashville and saw that they had knit this without sleeves and I loved it. When I go down again this year, I'm going to ask them what yarn it was because I'm sure it's a linen. That's about the only thing I know is I believe it's a linen blend, maybe a linen cotton blend, but there's no wool. This is not a wool. It's very light, very summery fabric. I want to get a sundress, or sundresses, I should say. And most of them have tops that are not, they're not for me, okay? Let's just let it go with that. They're not something I'm going to be able to wear. But the dress part is gorgeous. So I'm thinking if I just knit a couple of these kind of tops, I can, even if it's cropped and it's short, because you see, this is actually a short crop top. I doubt it would wear it by itself. But if I have a sundress and all I'm wearing is this crop thing to hide the tank and the halter and the little strappy things, and I'm covered, that'd be great. So to that end, I ripped the whole thing out. I am re-knitting it. And believe it or not, I'm almost done with the stockinette on the back. Like I said, it goes this way. You're actually knitting it from the top down. And I think I have to knit like 56 rows or something like that. And I'm on 30 something. And then just do the lace along the bottom. So that's where I'm at with this one. Unfortunately, this yarn has been a little bit difficult on my hands. And I have discovered a condition known as trigger finger. Live long enough. And it started after I had been working a lot, like after I ripped this out and was like crazy trying to get it back, knit back up again. But my thumb in the morning, the next morning, would like straighten up, but it would pop and then it would stay there. And then I'd have to like almost pop it back. And now it's doing that pretty much intermittently throughout the day. Now, I know I got to go and get that dealt with, but I keep hearing things like injection in the joint, and I'm like, that's not happening. No. Okay. I think I'll just live with my little trigger finger and go on about my business. And the other thing that has been getting some love, and mostly because it's kind of mindless knitting, and sometimes you just need that, although most of these are really just mindless stuff, is the Cardinia wrap. I did show this last week and I made minimal progress on it. I'm still here, but I'm almost done, I think, with this blue section. And I just happen to love it because of the colors.
Really?
I saw it on the headless dummy thing in Fiberspace, and I had to meet it. So again, this is kind of hard to make progress on or visible progress on because it's cast on from the long way. So each row does take a good amount of time. Now let's see if we can do this without. So I'm going to go to the thick spot and show you where I am. So again, it really doesn't look that much different from last week, but I have been working on it. I'm really enjoying knitting this, and this is knit out of Hazel Knits Artisan Sock, which is a nice fingering. It's just a nice, I think it's 100%, do I have a tag? Hold on, let me see if I have a tag on this. Don't tell me. All right, let's try one that I wound up. Hazel Knits. And their artisan sock is, what is it? This is the color Icicle, by the way. Oh, no, they're located in Seattle. Oh, yes, I did know. They're located in Seattle, Washington. It's a couple of the yarn stores I've gone to there said that they were local. It is... Okay, 90% superwash merino and 10% nylon. And the reason I looked is because this yarn actually has, I don't know if it's going to, yeah, you can see it. It's got quite a haze to it. It's got a really nice haze to it, but it's spun so nicely. It's plied nicely, and it's got some bounce to it. It's really, really really nice to knit with. It's a pleasant yarn to knit with, so which I'm glad, because you'll see I actually have another skein of this for something else. So those are really the three things that I have been diligently working on. So yeah, hopefully I will have another finished sweater for next week, and because of that I had to look at this. I got all my paper patterns here. I had to go to the local yarn store. Not like I didn't have any yarn. So I have a little bit of stash enhancement to show you because I just came back from the yarn store. So first off, I'm going to show you something that I had gotten. I don't think I had shown it yet on the podcast. I mean, I'm pretty sure it came while I was out of off on who knows what. I need to pull up the pattern because, what's it, how are we going to do this? Let's go over here, and my notebook, library, okay, this pattern was gifted to me by the designer, and I flipped. I absolutely flipped when I saw it. It is called Basket of Strawberry Shawl by Patricia McMullen. Okay, I hope you can get a good shot there. I know my lighting leaves a lot to be desired, but I saw this. Look at the bottom of it. It just, the shaping was beautiful, but the colors were just absolutely screaming to me. I loved it. So as soon as I saw it, and she was just so lovely, she gifted me the pattern. I had to get those same colors. So I did, and one of them, almost spilled the coffee, we're on a roll, is Dragonfly Fibers Djinny Sock, and it's called Springtime in Washington. And that's the variegated that she used. How gorgeous is that? Are those colors? I mean, they're just, it's just beautiful. All me. Just screams me. And then the other color was Jam Session. With this thumb, it's not so easy to open this stuff. And it's Hazel Knits, again, Artisan Soft, in the Jam Session. And these two together just were stunning. Stunning. So that's on my horizon. Probably when I get done with some of these summer sweaters before I cast on another, or finish, I should say, the half a dozen winter sweaters that I have that are just sitting and languishing because they are fofos on the needles. I might try to squeak this in because I really would love to have this for the fall. It's just gorgeous. So I have that. And another thing that I did get that I don't think I had shown yet was, I know Craftsy has turned into Blueprint, but they still have the store, the Craftsy store. I don't know how it works. If you go to Blueprint and you click on shop, somehow or another, but they always run sales. And when they run sales, they run really good sales. I'm talking like you can get a sweater's worth for like $30. I had always wanted to make this shawl. And when the kit went on sale, I was like, that's it, I have to do it. It is called Impulsive Shawl by Yellow Cosmo. And it just, oh my goodness. Is that my lighting? I don't know. Yeah, there we go. That's better. Anyway, I chose this colorway. Surprise, surprise. So I did get that. And I'm going to show you the yarn. I don't know. I don't want to give the wrong number and then anybody get upset with me. But, I mean, $16, something like that. It was one skein each. And it's their own yarn, which I have used several times for several different projects. This one is Cloudborne Fibers Merino Superwash Sock Twist. And this is in the colorway Petal and Heather, Taupe Heather. And that's the same colors that were used on the pink one that I showed you there. They are a little bit, I don't want to say darker, but the pink is less bright than it shows on there, and this is sort of a little bit more, I don't want to say sharp, but it's not quite as washed out looking as it is. The colors don't look in real life like they do on the picture, but that's okay because they're beautiful. And if you look in the pink, it almost has, and I know my lighting is terrible and it's hard to tell, but you can almost see like a brown heathering in here. So it really does pick up. So maybe when you knit them together, that's the end result. And because it picks up the pink becomes more vibrant. I don't know. You know me with color. You want color advice, don't ask me. Unless you want it to look like Clown Bar. So that was stuff that I had. And then today I went in and I was going to get yarn to make another of my finished object, which I can't believe I skipped right over that. So we'll get to finished objects after we get to enhancement. I was going to make another one, but then I decided we couldn't really find an appropriate yarn that didn't have wool. And you'll see when I show you the sweater, I don't think it's summer wear. Spring, yes. Maybe in the color that I chose, I can get away with it in the fall. But my point was to make a sweater or a top that I could wear over a dress. And I think if I put that top on a day like today, I'm going to look like a puddle with a hank of hair on top. There's no way. I can't. It's just going to be too hot. I don't care how short sleeves or how cropped. That wool is just too much for this kind of weather. So I decided, well, I like that tank top, and maybe if I go down a needle size, the stitches will look a little more neat, and I'll actually do a gauge swatch. So I purchased three more skeins of the Shibui, and it's the Shibui Fern, I think. Yes, which is 100% organic cotton. Okay, this is cotton. So for my size, I took three skeins of that and one skein of the Silk Cloud, the Shibui Silk Cloud, which is only for that little sheer flappy panel on the bottom. So I figured that little bit of mohair is not going to be a problem. And you knit it by it's holding one strand by itself. So it's really nothing. And you end up with a lot left over. So I have to figure something that I'm going to do with all of the leftovers I have from this. So anyway, I picked up the yarn to make another Mirage sweater. So I got that. And then I got, let's see, did I get? Okay. I don't know. I don't know how much of this I'm supposed to give away, so we'll hold on to that, and I'll show you on Ravelry. I picked up, I mean, this was like 30-something bucks. I was like, you gotta be kidding, this had my name all over it. Will you look at this bag? It's huge. It's absolutely huge. And I'm thinking for all of the knitting, in, you know, going to this appointment, that appointment, this appointment, I'm tired of stuffing things into my, trying to get them into my knitting bag or shoving it into my pocketbook and carrying all this crap. I'm like, I could shove everything into this bag. This bag is huge. And it has a really nice zippered pocket on the inside. It is thick. This is, I don't even know what it is. This is thick. Let's see what it says on here. Rock flower paper. Explore a world of color. I don't know. It just says rock. It's the Gigi bag by Rock Flower Paper. That's the only information on here. But the price point was just absolutely fabulous. It is 100% cotton. So I thought this was a great bag to fit everything, but what it's really great for is it's going to fit all of my pins that I'm going to show you. Because I have been collecting pins. I was going to show them last week, but that podcast ran so long. I was like, forget it. I can't even do that. So here we go into keeping in stash enhancement. I'm going to go over some of these pins that I got. Oh, my gosh. I also have makeup samples in here. Don't ask me why. I think the bag came with them. I just decided to hijack it for my pins. As many of you know, actually, most of my bags today don't have, well, one of them does. I have enamel pins on everything. I'm enamel pin crazy. These are just old ones. But I see them, and I go crazy. So I have gotten some recently. Actually, two of these just came yesterday. This is one from the Clever Clove, and this is from her Henrietta collection. This is one of her Henrietta summer ones, Henrietta's Amazing Adventures, limited edition. And this one has Henrietta holding a little beehive. So I have several of the Henrietta ones, so I had to get that one. And the other one that came yesterday, also from the Clever Clove, this is from her reading series, is a scene. It says on it, "Reader, I married him." And if you're familiar with the book, you know that that is the ending of the story Jane Eyre, the book Jane Eyre, which I happen to love. So this is from Nat. She has a literary series of all different book covers, sayings from books and whatnot. I think I have a couple that are from Little Women. So that was another one. This is what I pulled out last week when I was showing something. It's just a pin that I picked up from this year's Maryland Sheep and Wool. I have no idea where this came from, except my kids probably got it for me. And the reason I know my kids probably got it for me, just one of these says, because I said so. that's me. Mom life is the best life, and Mama Llama. So we got those. These I had, when I went to Maryland Sheep and Wool, we went to the Knot House in Frederick, Maryland. And Shelly Cam, who's one of the artisans that does pins and t-shirts and accessories and things like that, it's getting dark, so I think it's going to be a storm soon. I love her designs. Love her designs. I was too late to get two of the pins, so I had to wait. But I did order them. One was Old Bay. She did this one specifically for Maryland, because if you know anything about Maryland crab cakes and Old Bay seasoning, it's a biggie. But she spelled Obey, Old Bay, B-A-E, seasoning. Let's see if I can read what it says. Crafts with class and a dash of something. I don't know. Clearly, I need new glasses. So anyway, that was one. The crab was another one. Let's see if I can get that to focus. That she did for Maryland. And then this one I just saw on her site and had to have. And it's like a crystal ball with finished objects in it. Or future finished objects. I'm not sure. I don't hear anything. I'm telling you, ever since I saw that possum at my back door, now it's like, I don't hear anything. I don't hear anything. I don't see anything. I'm a meme. Completely a meme. Oh, here's another one. This is from The Clever Clove. And this is, I believe, Thornfield Hall, which is from Jane Eyre also. So that was another one. Here's another Henrietta, Amazing Adventures. And this is from her Summer Adventures. And this is Henrietta with her ice cream. So I have that one. I haven't put this on bag. I did get two Old Bay seasoning ones. I had to. Because I loves it. This is from Home Row Fiber Company. So I'm not sure where I got this one, but I love it. Ooh. Gosh, I know my lights are awful. Wait, maybe if I turn one off, let's see. I'll probably disappear. Is that better? Can you see that? Let's see. Yeah, okay. That's a little bit better. Now I'm sitting in the dark because it's getting darker in here and outside. Okay. Well, you get the gist. It's sheep. It's different sheep. All right, moving along. This is a llama with a basket of yarn on his back from Clever Clove. This one I also got two of because I love Susan and I love Desert Vista Dye Works. And Susan has now come out with enamel pins. So I have one on one of my bags. This is the second one. I love you, Susan. I cannot wait to see you on SSK. But these are so cute. And if you have not checked out Susan's self-striping yarn from Desert Vista Dye Works, go and check it out. You need, if you do socks, if you do mittens, if you do gloves, if you do hats, you need to check it out. Okay, moving along. Twill and Print. This one was, I love this one. This is the Phases of the Moon. And if I am not mistaken, I don't know who has the time to sit and do that, but as the phase of the moon changes, I believe, yes, you can swivel this, although I really can't get my finger in there right now, especially considering how sore it is. But you can change the phase of the moon. Personally, I would just put it on a full moon because around here, it's always a full moon, and leave it at that. This one is from, it's a typical brownstone. It's supposed to be indicative of the store, but this is from Brooklyn Yarn Company. I'm there all the time, and it just literally flew out of my head. I told you, my brain is like a sieve. It goes in, it goes out. Brooklyn Yarn Company, if that's not it, I'll put it down below. But anyway, that's their brownstone. That's their pin. I just don't know their name. And here's my last one. I don't know where this one came from. If I didn't know better, I'd say it was Gal, but it's not. And I think I'm starting to get punchy, which means it's probably been rambling on for too long. So let's just heap all this stuff back in here. And they're all sitting in this bag because I needed a bag to put them on. But now that I have that ginormous bag, it'll take a lot of pins. That'll be great. Okay, on to my finished object. How proud am I of myself? Look at what I finished in less than like a month. I finished my Arisu, and I am so pleased with how this came out. I'm not going to put it on. I have not blocked it yet, nor have I woven in the ends, but I love this. I did stick it on enough to see, because a lot of the pictures show that this V-neck really needed something underneath, that it came too far. Mine does not seem to do that. Now, when it blocks, I don't know. That may be a different issue. But it was super, super, super simple to knit. And that's why I wanted to knit another one. And at some point, I will. I probably will out of I'm going to say it's scratchy because I haven't washed it yet. It's probably not scratchy, but probably out of a softer, I don't know how to put it, sock type yarn. I don't know. We'll see. But I really was so pleased with how this came out and how it fit. And it's funny because I didn't gauge swatch. I used the needle and the stitches don't look as big as they did on my other. So I will swatch for the Mirage and see what's going on with that. But anyway, I did finish it. Again, my blocking and whatever pile is growing. One day I'm going to come on here. I swear that's all I'm going to have is like an hour's worth of finished objects that were finished months and years ago that finally blocked. Okay. That is it for knitting content. Sadly, yeah, there's still no spinning. I don't know. I need to do something to get my mojo going. I'm not sure what, but maybe go downstairs and take a look at the five wheels that are just sitting there doing absolutely nothing. That might do it. anyway, we are going to move on to our fragrance or scent segment. So if this does not, you know, isn't something you're interested in, that's fine. I totally get it. I will hopefully see you again next week. But if this is something, a journey that you are interested in taking with me or learning more about fragrance, then stick around because we are going to get into the fragrance I'm going to talk about today and a couple of other little tidbits that I'm going to give you that I've been learning about as I've been going along this journey. So what I wanted to talk about today, the fragrance that I'm going to talk about, I'm trying to keep it right now towards, and I'm not one to say this is a winter scent, this is a summer scent, this is a spring scent. However, there are some fragrances that I would not wear when it's 95 degrees outside with 100% humidity because I don't want to kill everybody standing near me, okay? I have some that are heavy and they project real, you know, you don't want to give everybody a headache and make their stomachs turn when they're already dying of the heat. But, you know, that's not to say that I wouldn't wear something that made a state. It doesn't have to be a florally scent or a light citrusy scent to be able to wear it in the summer. I just necessarily wouldn't want to wear, and it doesn't mean you can't wear a florally citrusy scent in the winter. There are just, you know, it's common sense. It's really common sense. So the, you know, I wanted to sort of stick with fragrances that are spring summer appropriate. In other words, I'll save my heavy oud ones for later on in the year when it gets cold. Please, gets cold outside. So that's it. It's not like I'm saying you can't wear this in the winter. You certainly can. You can't wear that one in the summer. You certainly can, depending on the occasion or whatnot. Okay, enough of that. This fragrance is by Tom Ford. It is called Soleil Blanc. I believe this is Soleil Blanc Toilette, and this is the Soleil Blanc Eau de Parfum, I believe. You can purchase. Now, I'm not one to buy, and I know they say it's more cost effective, which it is, to buy the larger bottle and all of that. That's fine if you know that you're going to wear, that you love that scent, that's a scent that you wear a lot, that's fine. Yes, then it is. But if you're trying different fragrances, and you're trying to find, filter out what you like and what you don't like, A, I would recommend samples. Sephora will give samples. Department store will give samples. Now, samples, part of all of what I'm learning here, you know the samples they give you, they're on a card, they're stuck in there, and they either, you know, you pour it on your finger. Nowadays, most of them are coming, you know, they are atomizers. That's a sample from the company. The type of sample that they make in Sephora when they are pumping it from the bottle into those spray things, that's actually called a decant. I didn't know that. And a lot of companies sell decants. I don't have any that I would recommend right now, and I would be very careful where I got it from because I'd be careful on eBay. I'd be careful on sites that I wasn't familiar with, but there are plenty of reputable places that sell decants in 5 milliliter sizes, 10 milliliters, whatever. And I would say a 5 milliliter sample is going to give you anywhere from 3 to 4 wearings. So that's an average. So when you purchase a decant, think of it that way. 5 mils is going to give you somewhere around, depending on how many sprays you use, is going to give you between 3 to 5 wearings. Let's set to be safe. And then multiply. 10 probably give you twice that, and on and on. That's the optimal way to really try something, is to either get a sample or get a decant. And what a decant is somebody who owns or goes and purchases a lot of, you know, bottles of perfume, does exactly that. They take the perfume, they purchase empty atomizer bottles, and they either unscrew the top and pour it in using a funnel and screw the top on and send it off to you, or they basically just spray it into the bottle, which is not, excuse me, the optimal way to do it. It's better to pour it, because you really don't want to expose the fragrance to the air. And all of this, again, to me, this is kind of like silliness. I mean, I'm not that much of a connoisseur. My idea of a good wine is one that tastes good. You know, I'm no connoisseur, and the same thing goes with perfume. If it smells good to me, it's a great perfume. If it could be $500 a bottle, which I ain't going to spend, so it doesn't matter how good it smells, or it could be $5 a bottle, it smells good, it's great perfume. That's my extent of connoisseurness. I didn't hear that. I hope nobody else did. I don't know what the hell that was, but I didn't hear it. Anyway, so that would be my recommendation. And what I'm getting around to is, I generally purchase fragrances, even if I've tried them, in the smaller sizes, because I'm not really hooked onto something yet. And the chances are, by the time I've gone through that, usually 30 mils, which is an ounce, I'm over it. I'm done. Or that point, I will go and buy the larger bottle. But when you have a lot of fragrance, they do keep, but depending on the amount of oil in them, the scent can change. I mean, oils do go rancid. I think once I had a perfume that didn't smell the way it did when I purchased it, but it was pure oil. So take it from there. So anyway, that brings me to the fact I got this happen. This is a prep to me. This is a very pricey fragrance, and unless I was sure I 125% loved it, I wasn't going to purchase a larger one. I did get a sample I used from Sephora. I did use that for a while, and then I ended up getting this, which is the 10 mil, I think. I don't know. It's like more than 10 mils, but maybe it is. But at any rate, you can purchase at some of the stores, department stores, just these refills, because this is actually just a really nice container. And then the refill just goes in and you put the top back on. So I figured this was the way to go for me, not to mention it was much more within my price range. So that is Tom Ford, and it's called Soleil Blanc. And the main accords of this, which is probably why I love it, is coconut, white floral. It's sweet. It's also yellow floral and tuberose. Those are the main accords. Okay, so let me give you the notes. The top notes are pistachio, pink pepper, cardamom, which I do not smell in this. I have to say, I don't smell it in that, but we'll get into that in a minute, and bergamot, which is not my favorite. The middle notes are ylang ylang, which, if you remember, I think that was in my fragrance last week, tuberose, and jasmine, and then the base notes, so the coconut is actually in the base. It's not one of the top notes. So the base notes are coconut, benzoin, tonka bean, and amber. Now, those notes, not so much the coconut, but the amber, the tonka bean, and the benzoin are, I don't want to say heavy, but they are really solid notes. They give a fragrance body. They give it warmth. So this is really an unusual fragrance in that it is very summery. You have your light white florals, your ylang ylang, you have your coconut, which right away screams tropical. The pink pepper, the bergamot, all are very light, but then it comes down into this ambery, tonka bean, benzoin notes on the bottom. So it is a complex fragrance, but it's beautiful. It is beautiful for summer. And like I said, I wasn't going to invest in this unless I knew I was going to love it. And even still, I wasn't investing in a big bottle of it. Mm-mm. Got too many perfumes. So I kind of saved this one. But it's a great, beautiful summer fragrance. This is one that I probably, and only because of the coconut note, and it's not, again, you're not going to smell like a coconut, but you can definitely tell there's a coconut fragrance and a note of coconut in it. To me, that one kind of does limit this to spring summer wear, which again is another reason why I got the smaller bottle, because I do not think I would take this into the fall or the winter. At that point, I would be looking for something different. But it is a beautiful fragrance. If you are looking for something that is summery, but not, that's the problem with a lot of summer fragrances, is that they're either pure citrus or so light that after an hour you don't smell them anymore, or they smell like suntan lotion, which, I don't know, at that point, just go out and get some Coppertone and smear it on, or Solade something, whatever you call that stuff. I don't lay in the sun, so I don't know. And call it a day, and you'll smell like the beach, if that's what you're looking for. I'm kind of searching for something that gives a beachy summer vibe without smelling like suntan lotion. Does that make sense? Because if you want to smell like suntan lotion, for heaven's sakes, just go out and buy some suntan lotion. That'll do it. I don't think that's what we're after here. And this does not do that. This does not, to me, smell like suntan lotion at all. It smells like a really lovely, summery fragrance. I can smell it through the bottle. It's driving me crazy. I have to tell you a funny, funny story. When the woman first, I was in Sephora, and we were trying all these different things. I was there with my daughter. And I mean, I'm always spraying fragrances all over the place. She sprayed it on the thing and wafted it and whatever. Because, you know, when you get that first blast, you're usually like, oh my God. My eyes, when I went to smell that, my eyes literally rolled back in my head. I've never had that before. I was like, oh my God, this smells amazing. So yeah, that's a new one on me. That's this week's fragrance. Couple of things I did want to say. Again, don't forget about Fragrantica. If you haven't, you can sign up there. I am Jan Ellen RN on there. I have tried to find out how you can find people on there. I'm not sure if there's a way. I haven't found it out yet. So if you sign up and you find me, I don't know that you can friend people. But you can look up, when you find somebody, you can look at their the fragrances they own, what they like, their reviews, what they've had and didn't like or didn't repurchase, what they want to buy. So it's really a great site. And again, like I said, there are forums on there. The other thing I wanted to mention, along with first going with samples, then if you find that you like something, if you can't find a sample of it, going with decants. And again, I will look into where to reputably purchase or reliably purchase decants. And when I do, I will put that below. I don't want to put anything that I don't know you're going to be getting the real deal and that it hasn't been sitting around for 6 years. And to that note, I want to tell you about a website. It actually, the company is local to me. So when I order from them, if I order on a Monday, I get my stuff Tuesday. It's amazing. And I've heard people that are in other states that also the shipping is phenomenal. The name of the company is FragranceX.com. I will link it below. They have hundreds of fragrances at a tremendous discount. And it is the real deal. I have bought a lot of fragrances from them. In fact, one of the fragrances, and it's a fragrance by Balenciaga. I actually bought it in the store and needed a backup bottle. It's the only fragrance I have a backup bottle of. So I bought it from them, and it is identical. It was packaged identical. I actually even scanned the barcode on it, and it did come up as the real deal. And they state on their website that they do not sell knockoffs. They only sell authentic. I'm going to tell you that you get, I believe the code is FX15. I don't get paid for any of the, I'm not sponsored. I don't have sponsorships, none of that. This is just saving you coin. Because this is where I get the bulk of my fragrances from. They sell at a hefty discount. Sometimes you have to join the waiting list, but they are, as far as I can, I know because I've used them many, many times, never had a problem. I also know that they are very good with returns. And also when you call them, when you have a question or whatever, a human being picks up the phone. So I highly, highly, highly recommend that company to buy fragrances from, because you get a tremendous discount. It is the real deal. I wouldn't recommend them if I didn't think so. So that is the last. That's all I have for you. This was supposed to be a short episode, and I have a feeling I rambled on again for over an hour. So if you stuck with me for this long, thank you so much. I hope you have a great week. I look forward to seeing you hopefully next week, and hopefully I will get this edited and up before I lose power, because it is getting awful dark outside. So until I see you next week, remember to knit with sense.